for David Lee Roth. David Lee Roth.
Your attention, please.
Welcome to Club Dave, where it only rains when we say so.
He said, yeah, you better come out with it. Go hands up, we got you surrounded. I'm in the back, changing my outfit. He said, Blake, we will send the house in. I said, wait, here I come, here I come, here I come. You boys be ready, cause here I come, here I come, here I come. He said, yeah, you better come out with it. Go hands up, we got you surrounded. I'm in the back, changing my outfit. He said, Blake, we will send the house in. I said, wait, here I come. Here I come, here I come. You boys get ready, cause here I come. Here I come, here I come, yeah.
I'm so rubber 100. How much charisma could another one stomach? If I be a prisoner, then I wasn't more cunning or wise. If I come outside, I'm not running. The stone lone wolf for the pack to unrun it. I really got nothing to hide, I'm about cutting. Go out in the blaze, wouldn't pop one button. I'm a merc, half hurt, lead a cop dog stunting. The pretty black one in the group, the smooth villain under fire, cause I'm pinning the words to move millions. Slide right in front of your eyes, true brilliance. It's a new bad moon on the rise, who feeling it? New true skill in it, charter root still in it. Ready plus willing, it's all a true killer shit. You know we get them involved with two diligence. They say the music is strong and too militant.
He said, yeah, you better come out with it. Your hands up, we got you surrounded. I'm in the back, changing my outfit. He said, Blake, we will send the house in. I said, wait, here I come, here I come, here I come.
You are connected to David Lee Roth. Prepare for combustion.
Just saw a whole entourage of folks coming in. We're in the recording studio here, and there's a huge Chinese entourage, folks who are recording for a variety of films and productions and kind of Broadway-esque types of shows. And I became really, really aware of what's happening in Asia, having just basically based out of there. Wherever the dog is where I live, okay? The leather jacket and the dog go wherever I live, and I'm lucky now that I can go, oh, I've always wanted to move to Japan, so I did. And I spent 2 summers, which is metric, for almost 2 years. Metric is a little bit less, right? And I went for a handful of reasons, a couple of different reasons. You know that I've started in the martial arts. That's pretty well knowledge, you know, and if you play baseball, maybe someday I'm going to go to Yankee Stadium. Maybe someday I'll take batting practice from so-and-so. If you play basketball, oh, maybe someday Kobe Bryant and I will work, you know, and maybe I'll play at the Forum and maybe I'll, you know, and everywhere has its own place. If I box, someday it'll be at the MGM Grand. Someday at Madison Square Garden, I'm going to be a bull rider and I'm going to do the PBR route and I'm going to be at Madison Square Garden and the huge event that they throw there. And you dream, and I always dreamt, hey, someday I'm gonna bust a move and I'm gonna do longsword practice in Japan. I'm gonna go do jiu-jitsu in Japan, etc. Also, I wanted a new paint job. There's a point in a man's life when you become a certain age when you're no longer scary to people. You might raise your voice, you might make a face, and they go, shut up, Uncle Bob. You're no longer scary, especially, you know, after, after 40 years old, 50 years old, but at 55, 60 years old, somewhere it's different for everybody, but there will become a point in your life as a man when you will no longer be threatening or scary to anybody around you. I think this tattoo solved that. It's not like my career path is going to get altered. I sort of know what the next 10 summers are going to bring. Eddie Van Halen aside, those are ups and downs. I don't know when we're going to tour, but I have a sense that we will. I don't know that we're going to record again, when that'll happen, but I have a sense that it's going to happen. It's not like I'm going to join a legal firm and one day I'm over at the Raquette Club and I pull my shirt off and it's, oh, shit! That kind of stuff can stop you up short, especially with a Technicolor paint job like I got. I also went to learn language. Language for me started many, many years ago. Lots of little Jewish kids start off with Hebrew school. It's the first time you understand that the kind of writing that looks like worms make under rocks, you know, when you lift up a stone and it's all squiggles, that's actually decipherable, pronounceable, and you can actually write messages with it. Your first exposure to that is Hebrew. In Hebrew school, preparatory to your bar mitzvah, you know, when you turn 13, you're a man, so you start to learn Hebrew and the culture more than anything. It's the culture. And once you begin to understand that's doable, nobody really walks around speaking Hebrew per se, unless you're Orthodox. But in terms of, oh, this is a really difficult language, and I can kind of bust a move in that. Then the jump to go, okay, let's learn some Espanol. Nos vamos en español. Órale! And the idea of rolling your R's, that's a doable prospect. That's something that is achievable. And language, I think the best artists are probably multilingual. Think about it. The Van Halen brothers speak a couple of languages. I speak a couple. I don't know if I'm the best artist. Picasso spoke three languages, and routinely you'll see this in all of the art forms, that folks who do speak a number of different languages have more of a capacity for the learning, perhaps to assimilate other ideas and add. And what's more current, you know, what's younger and skinnier than the remix today? Adding and subtracting all kinds of new stuff. International is big time, you know, whether you're listening to Pitbull's channel, which I recommend on Sirius XM, or you're a member of Beatport and you subscribe to that. Every other last name is barely pronounceable if you grew up, you know, outside of Arcola, Indiana. No, you've got everybody weighing in here. You know, you got places like, you have disc jockeys from Tikrit. You've got disc jockey teams from Akrotiri. I'm not even sure where that is, but it's a great name. I want the shirt. I moved to Japan and I start to pick up the language. I went 5 days a week, 2 hours a day, plus my homework. And I can get everything pretty much done that you need done. You want to go to the grocery, you want to know where the grocery is, what time the grocery opens. You got to tell the taxi guy, no, turn left. No, the other left. I had girlfriends like that in the modeling industry. They couldn't turn left. they just kept turning right until finally they're left. A lot of my career is like that. A lot of my experience in Japan was like that. I had a grocery store that was 24-hour. Downstairs in the shopping mall underneath where my apartment was. I was in the Oakwood Garden Apartments. It was a lot better than the Oakwood Garden when I stayed in it back in the late 70s or what have you. But the grocery store was very modern, and that's where I went to practice my Japanese lessons, because at 5 in the morning, 4 in the morning, I got jet lagged permanently. I have it at home in California. You know, I sleep like an alley cat, an hour here, 2 hours there, if 2 hours. I don't want to miss anything. I don't need coffee. And I'm a little hyperactive. And I got to know everybody, all of the folks who actually do the stocking of the aisles at 3 in the morning, the fellas who do the sweeping and the ladies who rearrange the displays and everything like that. And I would go downstairs and I would practice all of my moves, because everything I learned was conversational, okay, but from a boss's point of view. I don't ever ask the question, where's the bathroom or what time is it? Did we just observe an electronic whatever? Because those happen in Japan frequently. Anyway, I know how to say things like "kokini suruna," which means don't make a fool of me. Don't be ridiculous. I found I would use those things constantly. You know, routine. Huraitana, you have betrayed me. Gata rasena. Shut up. Come on, like family. I learned family talk. Or like we say at the television screen when we think nobody's actually around and you're eating popcorn and drinking soda pops and you talk to the screen and go, oh, come on. I know how to say all that in Japanese. As a lot like in English, though I'm not a very good listener. I learned how to do that in public schools, right? I can keep you going with really. Oh, far out. Omoshiroi. Interesting. I used that on my parents as I was growing up. But the foods that are in Japan is very Americanized. It's a lot of packaged. It's a lot of fried foods. And I come from the land of the super fried. I come from the land in Indiana where nobody blinks if mom buys the church's fried chicken, takes all the fry off the chicken, feeds it to the kids, and saves the chicken to give for the dog later. Okay, nobody blinks when that happens. Fried Oreos make perfect sense. Have you ever had fried Oreos? A lot of people haven't, and it's fun to make fun, but there ain't no making fun when you see the line of people outside the Krispy Kreme donut place. Imagine a Krispy Kreme donut that's been heated up so it's just short of going gooey, and in the middle is that crackery crunch, okay, from the chocolate wafer, and the white marshmallow in the middle turns into warm marshmallow goo. So it's sort of like four different, it's called the bite, or the consistency of what, you got four different bites going on in one taste there. You got the Krispy Kreme mush, you got the marshmallow goo, you've got the, there's four of them, believe me, you can count this up later. And it's all fried. And then you put, I think it's baking sugar or confectioner's sugar, that really fine, that's on top of it like this. It's like Dog the Bounty Hunter. It's everything that's great and a little bit left of sideways with America. It's the reason we're going to win this war, and it's probably the reason we're at war. So people hate us for this kind of a thinking. It's no different than a lot of confections you're going to find around the world. You know, when you go to Japan, you know what the kids eat that is really common? That's knockout cool. And this comes from after the war when there was rationing on sugar. You couldn't have, there was no chocolate, there was no dairy, there was no sugar. It was all on ration, and if there was any, it got used for the hospitals, it's, and the old folks, etc. Sweet potato. There are certain kinds of sweet potato. If you put it on a stick and really roast it slow over low coals for a long time, it's called yakimo. Yakimo. And you eat it like a popsicle. And you know how you can really slow bake? You've had this during Thanksgiving when it comes out like caramel syrup and it's just pure sugar, right? That's the way you give the kids candy. This is, it started after the war. And still today, instead of the Good Humor Man in the winter, you get the Yakimo man who sings Yakimo. And he sings, he has a song that is like the good humor song. And kids, a lot of high school students, that's their first job, is pushing a Yakimo cart that is like shaved ice, you know, from the Puerto Ricanos. And it's a lot like snow cones or the ice cream carts, or here you can get the juice, you know, where they're making juices and smoothies in the cart and like that, Yakimo. And it's addictive. It's completely addictive. You also got to carry a bottle of Pepto-Bismol. Or you'll be doing the Pepto-Bismols, which is purely American. They deny that ever happens in Japan.
One champion sound, yeah, Estelle, we about to get down. Who the hottest in the world right now? Just touched down in London town. Bet they give me a pound. Tell them put the money in my hand right now. Set up a motor, we need more seats. We just sold out all the floor seats.
Take me on a trip, I'd like to go someday. Take me to New York, I'd love to see LA. I really want to come pick you with you. It's really, really nice to meet ya. I just met this 5'7" guy who's just my type. Like the way he's speaking, his confidence is peaking. Don't like his baggy jeans, but I'ma like what's underneath it. And no, I ain't been to MIA. I heard the Cali never rains and New York's wide awake. First, let's see the West End. I'll show you to my bedroom. I'm liking this American boy, American boy. Take me on a trip, I'd like to go someday. Take me to New York, I'd love to see LA. I really want to come pick you with you. You'll be my American boy, American boy. Shopping, maybe then we'll go to a cafe. Let's go on the subway. Take me to your hood. I've never been to Brooklyn and I'd like to see what's good. Dressed in all your fancy clothes, sneakers looking fresh to death. I'm loving no show toes. Walking that walk, talk that slick talk. I'm liking this American boy, American boy. Take me on a trip, I'd like to go someday.
David Lee Roth a 6 da manhã.
Atenção, Barugam. David Lee Roth is a primo onde di minasse.
6 a.m. Very consistent.
My dog can sing in Japanese. Okay, it doesn't really. I sing Home on the Range and he goes, oh. But so do some of the members of my band. It's enough. It's enough to charge for a ticket. Russ was the perfect icebreaker in Japan because you have a whole generation of folks who are under 30 years old. I mean, probably half the country or two-thirds of this country or something. There's a big issue. And then you have a lot of folks who were through the war or lived through some portion of the restoration or whatever. It can be a little bit unforgiving walking around outside the bubble. And when you travel through Japan, you travel like a racehorse. When you go tour, you're there inside the bubble, we call it, for 2 weeks. You're going to go to the Hard Rock, where you're going to be catered to. They know you at the St. Regis, very familiar with international guests. They're very familiar, you know, with international folks in the Oakwood Garden where I was, and that was real part of the selling point, okay? Because I'm working the Van Halen project from there, even though I'm there. I'm living there. I'm not visiting. So everything, designing the album covers, the stage design, laying out the tour, lyrics and the clothing, endless amounts of details, get yourself a headset and have it bolted into place, because that's what you're going to for every 1 minute on stage, 4 hours on the telephone, 2 hours to facilitate that on the internet. And that's just you. That doesn't include the two production assistants, okay, which I had in Japan. I had to have the interpreter, who was different than the Japanese-speaking assistant, who was different than the person who was in charge of transportation. It was literally a million-dollar tattoo by the time the year ended. But something much bigger than just a paint job and a memory. I knew that it would change something inside of me by taking a trip like that. There's a point when you stop learning how to use the sword and you use the sword to teach you. There's a point when you stop learning to fly the helicopter. That'll be after about 3-4 years, and the helicopter will begin to teach you. The strength of patience will be first. Here we go. The engine just blew. Remain patient. See you tomorrow's lesson. And that's a big part of, you know, when you see me training with the sword, Japanese long sword. Some folks call it a samurai sword. That's the same as calling a 9mm Beretta a police gun. Yes, the police use it. Technically, though, it's not called a police gun. And a samurai sword, yes, they used a Japanese katana, which is a one-sided curved blade made of tamahagane ore. It's a certain kind of steel ore only. It is very flexible. It's non-brittle. You can bring it to an unbelievably surgical sharpness all the way to the point it will break if you crack it into stone, because you can't get the best of all worlds all the time. I think Kennedy said that. He was a samurai. No, you can't accomplish everything with one piece of gear. Anybody who knows digital knows that. No, there's no one driving wheel that's going to control virtually everything. So, well, wait. I can land the plane. I can open the garage door. I can signal the dog. Can you make me an espresso? See? Okay. The Japanese long sword is a specific item. I just bought one for, I got a really good deal on it. I spent right around $8,000 for it, and it's a little over 120 years old. It comes with a pedigree. It has papers. You have to license it the way you would a handgun. In Japan, you have to have that license with you anytime you transport. It's considered a more dangerous weapon than a handgun. I don't know that there's really only gangsters, mobsters have handguns in Japan, but the reason that you might even in some jurisdictions in the United States consider a sword or a knife a felony, whereas a handgun is a misdemeanor, is because a sword is silent. It can happen to you very quickly in the dark, and nobody heard anything but really, that's the truth of the matter. So it's a very serious situation, you know, when we transport them. You know, if you're in the car going to class, and I train in class with a live blade, it's, you know, that's like a giant sushi knife, you know. The purpose is you're using, once you get to that, and that's like surfing 40-foot waves, you don't start there. You start on baby slopes and you try something a little bigger, a little steeper the next time, etc. Over the period of summers or seasons, you're trying the bigger and bigger. Ultimately, if you take it to a lifetime pursuit, you may decide to train with a live blade, something that's actually sharp. And when you reach that point, you're then using the implement, you're using that weapon to train yourself. You've already mastered whatever the various postures are, or whatever the various breathing sequences are, and it's what we'll call be cool school. What you'll lose first will be your toes. The down sweep. As soon as you sweep it in a half circle, the first thing most people waste is their big toe. Second thing that you will waste will be your, if you're right-handed, will be your left thumb as you draw and put it back into the scabbard. These are sequential injuries that we know to expect. And this is the whole idea. You know, why did I bother learning to fly a helicopter? Be cool school. sticking rudder? Yeah, I got that in a few years. Staying cool when everything else happens, while life happens to you up there, is the whole part of the pursuit. Why did I go through a rock climbing phase? Oh, the gymnastics of it, great. Great way to sample and enjoy the outdoors. But once you've learned the moves and you know the knots and you know the techniques, you begin to use that mountain to teach you. And you enter into a whole new cycle of education. It becomes perhaps more introspective. So when people ask me about Japan, how was the food? How was the architecture? I don't know. My whole trip was inside.
Is on, I'ma spit my flow. Trip the lights, fantastic disco show. Hit the mofo back in the bliss withdrawal. And not worry about friends or foe. Oh, or just pop the X, maybe have lots of sex. Hop the next flight to a spot that's less saturated, so it's no need to stop the press. And throw back in that Michelin S. Yes, as if the groove is on, I'ma spit my flow. Trip the lights, fantastic disco show. Hit the mofo back in the bliss withdrawal. And not worry about friends or foe. Oh, as if life is slow when the groove is on. And watch trend take shape in the musical form. Anything I'm on, hot, not usually warm. Make it hard, you refusing the song, yo.
Come on.
Life is slow when the groove is on. Trip the lights, fantastic disco show. Life is slow when the groove is on. Life is slow when the groove is on. Life is slow when the groove is on.
Took my dog to Japan, which was a big to-do. You've got to get a special service, right? Unless you have a tiny little dog that, I don't know, maybe you wouldn't put it on a seat next to you. It's a 12-plus hour flight. Well, my dog held his whiz. But that was only after the first time. He learns really quick. I was amazed at his bladder control, okay? Talk about velocity. As soon as we cracked the door on that after breaking customs, whoo, that dog was a blur. Irregardless, though, I had to get a special service that costs an arm and a leg to ship a dog like that. Russell is a cattle dog, Australian cattle dog, and he weighs about 55 pounds. So he's kind of middleweight. He takes up the whole seat in the truck, but you can lift him into the seat. He's not so big that you can't lift him. Other dogs that are bigger have a rib cage that's the size of a 14-year-old. No, too big. And I don't know that those dogs travel so well. I got an off-road dog because I knew that Russ could take the heat and the cold and whatever. You ever see the movie Mad Max? Mad Max has an Australian cattle dog. The cattle dog always hovers out on the perimeter. He's a really good guard dog. He's not the best family dog. People like to think of the Irish setter or whatever by the fire. Dad's reading the paper, smoking the pipe. He's got his feet up on the cushion. The kids are playing Monopoly. There's a flame in the fireplace. Mom is knitting. Johnny Carson is on. This is not that kind of dog. Cattle dogs are engineered to find the perimeter of where the light falls off. So if you have a campfire and it throws 360-degree circumference of light for about 5 feet, the dog will sit about 7.5 feet away from the center of that fire in the shadows. He's kind of like Bill Murray in Caddyshack. He's always lurking in the tree line. And that's why he has that George Clooney. Come on, that gray and black salt and pepper haircut. Clooney, the actor. Is it George? Okay, you know how his hair color is that salt and pepper gray and black? Well, that's what the dog looks like with a raccoon kind of goggle on his face, okay? When I'm in the elevator and people ask me, is that a wolf? I tell them, no, it's a seeing eye raccoon. I'm a wolf, baby.
Oh!
And I'm not lying. That kind of dog will sit, and he shoots and moves. He stays in one place for a few minutes, and then he'll move about 6 feet. And you'll never see him moving until you call him and go, Russ! And he pops out of the last place you would ever expect and goes, yeah, what's up? About every 14 to 20 minutes, and you can set your clock to this, okay? My language teacher tripped out on this. She was, maybe in her early 50s, great gal, right? We spent 5 days a week together, hours and hours and hours, and when I brought the dog, she'd never seen a dog like that. Most of the dogs in Japan are very, very small and condensed because they're, you know, you gotta spend a lot of time with the critter. Otherwise, they act out. Okay, they're very energetic. A smaller dog is easier to control. My dog has what we call grandfather's mind. Seen it all. He's about 70 years old by human standards. He's about 10 summers long, okay? So he's really good around kids, wheelchairs, kids who put their fingers in all the wrong places. I'm okay with that with, you know, older kids. I don't care where she comes from. She's a seeing eye raccoon. I think she's an Eskimo. I don't know. Give me here. Use my finger. I won't look. I actually know how to say that in Japanese. Anyways, no, I'm not going to say it. But there is a new day on the other side. There's a new day on the other side. I can see the look. No, that's really what it means. You got to be strong. Gotta be strong to walk through the night. I said that in a Japanese sushi bar. He said, I believe this to be samurai expression. I said, no, that's Foursquare Gospel Baptist. Gotta be strong to walk through the night. Yeah. Yes, you do, sister.
Free challenge.
Woo! Pass the sushi. Now I'm gonna have some sweet potato. Yeah, some are high, some are low. I don't care. Good to go. They never did get my sense of humor over there, but they did love the way I say it, which kind of applies historically to the Van Halen audience as well. I made an actual quote that I made pursuant to Miles Davis. One of his most famous quotes was, man, if you understood everything I'd said, you'd be me. Put that one on the gravestone, right? You know, what's going to go on your gravestone? I don't know. The two words that got me into the hole, that put me there, will be the two words that accompany me to heaven. I'm in. What are you guys doing after this? Doesn't matter. I'm in. Are you guys going somewhere after? I'm in. I got a car. Yeah. Everybody thinks my two words would be screw you. No, my two words are... I'm in. I know, it's kind of a remix of Isaiah chapter 6. Send me, baby. Send me.
Send me. Send me. Send me.
Relax and let your mind flow way downstream.
freaking.